God's word, the heart of man. This is going to be part three. We've started this study for a few weeks now on the heart of man. So today is going to be part three of, on this topic, the heart of man. So, your heart is the headquarters of you. You, your being, your personality, your intelligence, quotient. It's a great processor of information. So when the Bible is talking about the heart of man, what the Bible is saying is the heart, as according to the scriptures, is the thinking of man, where all the thoughts are being evaluated. So you can say it's a man's will, a man's emotions, feelings, a man's conscience, combinations of any of this, of everything. So man is body, soul, and spirit. So the soul of man containing or having in these divisions, your feelings or your emotions, your will in this division, and of course, you know, sometimes we talk, we said someone has a strong will, someone, you know, has this or that, and your mind. So if you combine this together, you say soul of man, you can as well say the heart of man. So the heart of man, according to the scripture, and according to this message that I'm giving you today, this part three, when I'm saying the heart of man, I'm talking about your thinking faculty, where you have all the thoughts, where you take decisions on what to do and what not to do. So the thinking of a man, the whole inner being of a man, combining all these elements, can be called the heart of man. So, the heart of man is so important. The heart of man is so important and such that God himself desires or wants our mind. Let's see the scriptures quickly. Proverbs chapter 23 verse 26 says, "My son, give me your heart, and let your eyes delight in my ways." So, your heart is so important to God. And so God is asking that you give him your heart. You know, it's just like, if I ask you a question, if somebody should give you this offer, take a room in this building, or take the whole building, or have the whole building. So a man of normal sense will say, okay, I want the whole building. Because if you have the whole building, then you'll be able to have opportunities to go into any of the rooms. But if you just take the choice of just one room in the whole building, then you may be locked out. So God is asking for you. And you is your heart. You is your heart. Everything that you do is decided right in your heart. So your heart is very, very important to God. When you think, when you decide what to do. Proverbs 4:4 says, "Then he taught me and he said to me, 'Take hold of my words with all your heart. Keep my commands and you will live.'" So, if the words of God is taking or is dwelling in us, in our heart, and it will help us to survive in life, it will help us to take good decisions, it will help us to live. Say, "My son, do not forget my teaching, but keep my commands in your heart." Proverbs 31. And look at the psalmist. In Psalm 119 verse 24, it says, "Your statutes are my delight, they are my counsels." So when the word of God is in our heart, it will counsel us, to help us to take good decisions. So the heart of man, very important. And so, last week I began to give us some important factors on what we can do about the heart of man because of what the scripture says. So I want to continue from there. Now, since our thinking faculty is called the heart, then what do you think we can do to ensure that we think right? It's a place of thought, where you reason, where you take understanding within you. And the difficult things about this is that the thought could be evil and the thought could be good, all within the same heart, where you think and where you process everything, where you decide on what to do. So it could be evil, it could be good. And about our heart, fall, after we fell in the Garden of Eden, our heart has been polluted. And check what the Bible says in Jeremiah chapter 17 from verse 9 to 10. Jeremiah 17, 9 to 10. Are you all with me today? This is part 3 of the heart of man. You're going to enjoy it. Amen? Amen. Look at Jeremiah chapter 17 from verse 9 to 10. It says, the heart is deceitful above all things. The heart is so deceitful. Your heart can deceive you. That's what the scripture is saying. And it says, and beyond cure. The deceitfulness of the heart of man is not something you can cure. There are doctors here today. They can bear witness with me that there are some diseases that cannot be cured. So far right now, if I'm right, the last time I've checked it out, I don't know if I may be wrong, no cure for AIDS. Acquired immune deficiency syndrome. There is no cure for it. Of course, though there is no cure for it right now, if I'm right, but you can control it. You can take medication that can help you to manage it, right? Okay. And there are some other diseases like that. If you get this, you cannot cure it, but you can control it. Now, about the issue of the heart of man, the scripture is so clear. He said, in that Jeremiah 17 from verse 9, I just want you to get this right. If you get this right, the more information you have about this, the better your life will be. Then you will live a successful life. You will avoid yourself of unnecessary mistakes in life. The heart of man is very, very deceitful. Please notice that. And the Bible says, not only that the heart of man is deceitful above all things, but beyond cure. You cannot cure the deceitfulness of your heart. You get me right now? You cannot cure it, deceitfulness of your heart. You cannot cure it. But if though you cannot cure it, you can do something. You can control it. You can manage it. So that verse, phrase in that chapter 9 says, who can understand it? Verse 10, I the Lord search the heart and examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, according to what their deeds deserve. Now what we are saying is that though the heart of man is deceitful, it's deceitful. Of course, the deceitfulness cannot be cured. Now God is saying that, I search your heart, I search your mind to see what you are doing, to see the soul that you are taking, because you will be rewarded based on your decisions. So you cannot blame God, say, God, you created my heart to make it deceitful. So if I do anything, I'm not responsible. No, you are responsible to every action you will take right in your heart. And that is why it's so important that you take notice of this and then you do something. Now, last week, then we said, I asked you a question. I said, what then can we do? The heart is deceitful above all things, beyond cure, cannot be cured. What then can we do? Where can we stand? What can be done? Are we without any help? What do you think we can do about this? I was reading some kind of news that somebody was saying that in those days, when there are no medication for simple disease like diabetes, that so many people have died. Simple disease like that, diabetes, so many people have died. Some of the diseases now that you can even get immunization to prevent the infestation of those diseases. They say in those days, nothing like that. People die easily of those things. But right now, there are so many medications for so many diseases that even people are living longer. Now we have whatever to retirement. People are living longer because there are so many medications for so many diseases. But there's something again. Do you know something I want to tell you right now? Are you ready to hear this? Though there are medications for some diseases, of course, that can be managed. Do you know that on your own you can take decision not to take those medications and then accept to go, accept to die? It's like committing suicide. And give you instances of people that I knew that are gone. Diabetes. Just to take your insulin, just take it. I'm not a doctor, but if you take it, it will help you to regulate the sugar in your blood, right? For some people say, no, I can't, I'm so tired of this and that. And of course, you don't regulate it, you don't manage it, it will break you down. And not only break you down, it can take your life. So the heart of man has to be managed. As you take care of your body, as you exercise, you filter whatever you eat, you take choices of what you eat, you do some exercise, and you try to ensure you avoid taking some additional risk. The way you take care of your physical body, you get to take care of your spiritual body, you, your heart. Amen? You got to control it. You got to manage your heart. And so, I now asked you a question last week. What then can we do, though we cannot cure it, we have to manage it? And the first thing I told you is this. I said, guard it. Protect it. Protect your heart. Guard your heart. Be the security guard of your heart. Why? Proverbs 4:23 says, above all else, guard your heart. For everything you do flows from it. All that you do in this life flows from your heart. So please, protect your heart. Guard your heart. Do not just let anything go there. Amen? Amen. And I gave you so many other verses. And then I said the second one is this. Occupy it with positive things like God's words. Let the word of God dwell in your heart. Don't let your heart be vacant. Occupy your heart with God's words. Amen? Amen. And I gave you verses in the Bible, Psalm 1, from 1 to 3. And I also told you the Paul's instructions or advice. Now, I want to go for more points so we can have time to see all these things. So when your heart, soul, spirit, mind, and emotion feelings is absent from this body, it's rested with the Lord. It's not only the fact that your heart cannot be cured, but your heart also cannot die. So you cannot say, oh, okay, I'm not going to cure it, I will allow it to die, like you won't take some medication now. No, your heart, your soul will remain forever. It's created to remain forever. Ecclesiastes chapter 3, verse 11 says, God has placed in the heart of man eternity. So your heart is eternal. And I told you last week, where you will spend eternity, or where your heart will continue to remain after dwelling in this body, because one day your soul will depart from this body, and that's what we call death. One day, you like it or not, it's true, your soul will depart from this body, and when your soul departs from this body, it's going to live somewhere. So where is it going to live? Because it's not going to die, it's going to stay somewhere forever. Your thinking, everything, it's not going to die. You will still be thinking. After you have left this body, you will still be thinking. Amen? Amen? It's eternal. Your heart is eternal. Your soul is eternal. Your mind is there. You are created to live forever. So where you spend eternity will depend on the decision you have taken when you are in the body. Believe me, you still be thinking after you have departed this place. Jesus gave a parable of the rich man and Lazarus. Rich man was thinking, Lazarus was thinking. Rich man remembered Lazarus very well. So when he saw Lazarus enjoying because of this one Lazarus has taken while he was in this body, he was enjoying, he was somewhere we call paradise, he was in the bosom of Abraham. The rich man also was thinking, oh, I'm suffering here. I can ask Lazarus because Lazarus knew me very well while we were in the world to come and help me do something. And he sent petition to Abraham. It was rejected. You know that story very well, right? So it's when they were still thinking, they can remember what happened here on earth. So your soul will remain forever. Your heart will remain forever. So decide, take a good decision on where you spend your eternity by giving your life to Jesus Christ as your personal Lord and Savior, so that after you have left here,
your soul will remain in a place of peace. Bible says any soul that sins must die. That kind of death we are talking doesn't mean that your soul will stop from existing. Your soul will continue to exist, but where it's going to continue to exist will be somewhere, place of punishment, because we have rejected the Lord Jesus Christ. So if you want your soul to remain somewhere where there will be joy, where there will be peace, where there will be enjoyment and singing and praise and glorious place, then you have to decide today to accept Jesus into your life. So let's go to the third one. What can we do if the heart cannot be cured? Then what can we do? I told you of guarding your heart, and I told you of allowing positive things to be in your heart, occupy your heart with God's word. The next one is, do not allow external influence. The heart can do both good and bad. Do not allow bad things to influence your heart. You know, you see Proverbs chapter 4, from verse 19 says, hear my son and be wise, and guide your heart in the way. This one is different from guard. Guard your heart is different from guide your heart. Guard your heart means protect your heart. Protect your heart from any manner of things that will destroy your life. So, you are security guard of your heart. Now, Proverbs 4:19 is saying, guide your heart. That is, control your heart. Instruct your heart. Direct your heart. It's your responsibility to do what? To direct your heart. Do not allow external influence. There's some very bad influence you don't want it to come into your life. Guide your heart in the way. Do not mix with wine bibles or with gluttonous eaters of meat. For the drunkard and the glutton will come to poverty, and drunkenness will clothe a man with rags. That is verse 11. Be careful the people you associate yourself with. You have to guide your heart. If you guys are recently, those of you that have read the newspaper or you are listening to news, just last week, two retired police officers, Chicago police officers, they are both 61 years old, planned together. It's in the news. They both planned, these men planned together. They knew somebody who has access to money, big money, and some properties. So they plan together to get this person who has access to money, kill him, cut his body into pieces, and destroy the body so that people will not know. But before they will kill this person, they said they will force him to release all the money. And they will ask him to sign documents to release all the properties. But while they were planning this, government was also training them, and they were both arrested. Now I ask question, when this happened, what is going on with these two men? These are grown up men, 61 years, what are they going to do with this money? This money, hello, 61 years old, they are retired government officials, they have money, they have their retirement. And they desire to kill somebody because they want more money, more parties. Now, what are they going to do? And these are law enforcement people. They have been trained with taxpayers' money to know how to protect crimes. Now, they are using their training in a wrong way to commit crime instead of protecting crime. Hello? Guide your heart. The law of the group. I explained this a little bit last week. The people that you associate yourself with, sooner or later, you will become like them. If you associate yourself with criminals, very soon you will become a criminal. The law of the group. If you associate yourself with good people, people that fear God, people that respect human beings, people, look, we know that only God is good. But look, you can train your heart to do the right thing. You can guide your heart to take good decisions. If you associate yourself with people like this, people that fear God, people that will not do some stupid things like this, you are wise. Hello? You become like that kind of people. If you associate yourself with people taking drugs, very soon you'll be carrying drugs. They will expose you to that. If you access, that's what this place is saying. If all your friends are people that are staying so long on alcohol, they drink until one day you want to test it. I would have been a very big smoker. But when I was in secondary school, my parents, they thought I was in the school doing all that I was supposed to do. But where I was staying was outside the school. And I had some people like me, young men like me. I always see them, they will come, they, you know, that time is like, you know, you just want to show that you belong. You belong. They will come, and some of them will take cigarettes, they will be smoking, and they will always offer me cigarettes. They didn't ask me to pay. They don't want to offer me. So one day, I look at them, I don't want to look like, you know, and you know, you remember this one thing. Those of you that have been to Nigeria, if you are from Lagos, you are from Lagos, and you travel outside Lagos to some other inter-cities, maybe like Oyo State, like Osun State, or like Wara, you go to that kind of places, where you meet some boys, like your group, you want to show them from Lagos. I'm a Lagos boy. You want to be the trainer. You don't want them to train you. You want to be the trainer. Because you say, ah, it's from Lagos. Yeah, it's from, and you want to show that you are from Lagos. The way you dress, the way you talk, all those things. Sometimes, Seleto, you put on, you know, you get your shoes, you go to a shoemaker to help you put some steel here. So when you are walking, it's make noise. Why is that guy always from Lagos? You walk and your shoes will make noise. It's from Lagos. So you want to show that. So when these people, these boys were smoking, I want to show I'm from Lagos. I drink with them. You know, that one is normal. You drink with them. And so that I asked one of them to give me the cigarette. So he gave it to me. They have been offering me for free. They gave it to me. As soon as I put it, I started coughing. That was it. That was the way God took me out of that. If I had taken it, if they had taught me how to do it, they didn't teach me. Because they thought I'm from Lagos, I should be able to teach them, not them teaching me. They would have taught me how to do it, because they said, when you do it, it's not going to make you cough like that. But I did it in a long way, I was coughing. And that was it, I stopped it. I would have become like them. Because I associate myself with them. The law of the group. If you mix with people that are evil, very soon you become evil. So watch out what you do. And the Bible is so clear about this. You cannot cure the deceitfulness of the heart of man, but you can manage it, you can control it, you can guide it, you can guide it. And that's what God requires from you. If you look at the Ecclesiastes chapter 7, verse 15, it says, I have seen everything in my days of vanity. There is a just man who perishes in his righteousness, and there is a wicked man who prolongs life in his wickedness. You know, sometimes we make it, we will be thinking that if you do anything bad, you get away from, you know, from that thing. But we are going to pay a price. And that's why you have to guide your heart and ensure that you take right decision. Because there will be always consequences to every decision or any choice you have taken in your life. So if you guide your heart and protect and manage your heart and ensure you take the right decision, the consequences shall be good consequences. Amen. You are not going to be bad consequences. The heart of man is deceitful, in fact, is desperately wicked. Only God can know it. If you don't cure, you can protect it, you can guide it, you can fill it with God's word. Let's quickly go to the next one. Let's go to the next one. This is number four. Cast down every nonsense. Tell somebody, cast down every nonsense. Brethren, if anything wrong is coming to your heart, come on, check it out right now. Don't even dwell on it. Look at what the Bible says in 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 5. It says, casting down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Every thought that is coming, bring it to the captivity. Please, protect your heart such that when anything is coming that you know this thing is not in accordance to God's word, Bring it under shame. Shame it. Don't even give it a single thought. Shame it. Bring it under subjection. You are in charge. Hello? Even if God, see, you know, the way God created us such that we are responsible to every decision. For the most part, God is not going to force you to do anything. Because you are what? You are in charge of your life. And that is why you give account of everything that you have done in this flesh. You are in charge. Don't say, devil made me do it. You have accepted to do it, that's why you did it. Cast down, the Bible is clear here. Cast down arguments and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, the knowledge of God's word. Bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Every thought in your heart, bring it to the captivity, to the obedience of Christ. And I want to ask you a question. What is the obedience of Christ? If this one we're going to explain, if we're going to just explain this number four, and then go home, we can continue next week. I want to be very, very clear with you. But one thing that I want you to know that is the reality is this. Your heart is deceitful. Hello? You don't know your heart. You don't know your heart. If you direct your heart, I'm telling you this now. If you direct your heart, you'll be surprised what devil can make you do. If you don't listen to God's word now and understand this word, God's word, and protect your heart and manage your heart, you'll be surprised what devil can make your heart do. Do you know that these two retired police officers that were caught in this planning, they are not yet convicted? So don't say, hey, Pastor, why are you judging them? I'm just telling you what I heard. But for the fact that they were being arrested, government is not stupid. For government with zero on you, they have some facts. So because they have been arrested, they are not being judged, they can get away from it. They can say, oh, they get high. You know, this know what they do. They get very good lawyers. He has a bipolar. He has a depression. In fact, when he was taken, his wife was running away. That's why he was planned. He got a financial problem. They can have all the excuses and this and that. But do you know one thing is this? That this man, if they had known they can be caught, they will never plan this. They will never. But that is going to tell you, be smart. You can do it. After somebody else. They will be telling you people that have done it that have not been caught. It's not going to tell you those that have done it that were caught. If you don't protect and guard, also guide your heart, you will be surprised what the devil can make you do right in your heart, and you will plan everything. You will be the architect, you will be the master planner, you will be the chief operation officer, and everything will be executed. And listen very carefully. You will not, even if you get away from it in this world, you give account to God. Protect yourself, brethren. Be a good person. You can be a good person by following God's word. You can be an asset to your community by following God's word. You can avoid being a liability on your generation by following God's word, by ensuring that your heart is clear, by ensuring that you fill your heart with positive things, by ensuring that you fill your heart with God's word, the knowledge of God's word, and all the time you are in charge. As any thought is coming that you know this is evil thought, you bring it under subjection. Under captivity, you shame it. You never allow it at all. You can do it. You have the ability to do it. Hello? You can do what? You can do it. Before I go to number four, I want to show you something. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 3. Look at 2 Samuel chapter 22, verse 3. He said, for by you I can run against a troop. By my God, I can leap over a wall. For anybody who depends on God, for anybody who trusts God, you can do things that are imaginable by the enemies. You know what it means to run through a troop? You know what it means? To run through a troop, people with guns and you know, all those weapons of warfare, you run through them. Only by God can you do that. And he said here that you can leap over a wall by God. So you can do it. You can can guide it. You can manage your heart. You have the ability to do that. Do you know God is not going to ask you to do what He knew you cannot do? If God knows that you cannot do it, you cannot protect your heart, you cannot guide your heart, you cannot guide it, you cannot put it, bring it under subjection, the Bible is not going to tell you to do it. But because of the fact that you have the ability to do it, God is telling you today to do it. So, what is the obedience of Christ? What is the obedience of Christ? If the Bible is saying that, I told you cast down every nonsense, and the Bible is saying that casting down argument and every high thing that exalts itself against the knowledge of God, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. So I ask you, what is the obedience of Christ? Give me a few minutes, we are going to go. Amen? So what is that obedience? And I put it this way. To love God, to lay your treasures above in order to keep your heart on heaven. The obedience of Christ is this. God wants you, the way you can protect and manage and guard your heart is to ensure that your heart is focused on your future. Tell somebody, let your heart focus on your future. Your future is eternity. Your future is heaven. And so, the obedience of Christ is to ensure that your heart is focused on heaven. That is the only way you can bring your heart under subjection. That's the only way you can bring it under what this place is called obedience of Christ. Say, bringing every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. Matthew chapter 6, brethren. Matthew chapter 6 from verse 19. Matthew chapter 6 from verse 19 says, do not make up for yourselves treasures on earth where moth and rust destroy and where thieves break in and steal. But make up for yourselves treasures in heaven where neither moth nor rust destroy and where thieves do not break in and steal. For where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. Where your treasures is, where will your heart be? Your heart will be there also. If you want to bring your heart under the subjection, under the obedience of Christ, then you have to focus on the future. You will not focus on material things in this place. You will be able to, as the word is coming in, as the subjection is coming in by the enemies, you will be able to, you know, filter those subjections based on God's word. That is the only way you can bring everything under subjection, under captivity. So that you are not taken away from here. If you place your heart so much on things that are here, it's going to be very hard for you to control your heart. Because before you know it, those things can have you. And when those material things should have you, then you are finished. Your heart is gone. Look at what Paul says, Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. From verse 1. It says, if then you are raised with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ is, sitting at the right hand of God. That is the obedience of Christ, seeking things that are above. Set your mind on things above. You set your mind, you set your heart on the things of God. If you set your mind, if you set your heart on the things of God, you will have the fear of God. And the fear of God is the beginning of what? Wisdom. It's the beginning of wisdom. Wisdom to handle life affairs. Wisdom to handle business. Wisdom to handle, you know, your family. Wisdom to handle your friends. You need those wisdom. And you will not have that those wisdom if you do not set your mind on things above, not on things on the heart. Say, for you die and your life is hidden with Christ in God. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with Him in glory. No, you cannot understand what your heart knows until you depart this body. Your heart, you cannot understand 10% of the ability of your heart, what your heart can do. You cannot understand. If Christians should do the right thing, like Colossians, Paul was saying here to Colossians, if Christians are dead to their body, as they're supposed to, then their heart will be at peace with God. Their heart will be right with God because they will never seek things that are here. They'll be thinking of the future. They will do the right thing like people do in this place, in this world. Do you know that in this world, can you ask this question? How do we come about retirement? How do you come about 401k? Why in your office where you work, they pick some of your money, they put it somewhere planning for your retirement? Why do they do that? Because they know they have to plan for future. Because they know that they have to plan for you. Even if you don't want to do it, you cannot go to them and say, I don't want to retire. Don't take my money. Can you go tell them that? In most offices, they will not hear, they will not listen to you. Either you want to retire, don't want to retire, they will take that money. And of course, it's gambling. You may not even retire. Amen? You will retire in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Not everybody that will contribute to retirement, we tap from that retirement. Not everybody. Some people will go before they even qualify to tap from it. Some people put that money there. But someone else can still tap from it, maybe their family. If that is right, why can't we also as believers think of our final retirement, eternity? Where we're going to spend eternal life with God. Why can't we continue to look forward to heaven, look forward to our future, be dead to this flesh, which is temporary, and then be alive to eternity, be alive to things of God, focus on God, doing the right thing based on the scriptures. Look at verse 4, it said, when Christ, who is our life, appears, then you also will appear with him in glory. Therefore, put to death your members, which are on the heart, fornication, uncleanness, passion, evil desire, and covetousness, which is idolatry. Because of these things, the wrath of God is coming upon the sons of disobedience. You control your body on these issues. Because it is your heart that will be the architect of those actions. If you can control that, your heart, then you'll be able to control those evil desires that can destroy you and that can take eternity from you. Verse 7, in which you yourselves once walked when you live in them. But now, you yourselves have to put off all these anger, wrath, malice, blasphemy, filthy language out of your mouth. Do not lie to one another, since you have put off the old man with his deeds, and have put on the new man who is renewed in knowledge, according to the image of him who created him, where there is neither Greek nor Jew, circumcised or uncircumcised, barbarian, sentient, slave or not free, but Christ is all and in all. Amen.
Amen.
So, what Paul was telling the Colossians, the Bible is telling us today, that these things will be possible, we can put all these things into action, if only we can do that thing, put on that subjection, our heart. And as this number 4 says, casting down or cast down every nonsense that may filter through your mind. Doing the right thing, taking the right decision. Be in control of all those information coming into your heart. Be at alert. Don't sleep. You can never allow yourself to sleep 1 second taking decision in your heart. One may regret. The Lord bless us in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The heart of man is very hard and very difficult. And of course, I told you that the study is a very wide study. We have over 800 times that the word heart appears in the Bible. Over 800. And we have over 700 verses on the heart, the word heart, the heart of man. And it's so important because it will determine all the words we are hearing. Right now, as I'm talking to you, I'm just rising now, we're going to pray right now. As I'm talking to you, your heart is functioning, it's working, your heart is thinking. Your heart is thinking, your heart is just thinking. Do you know how much work your heart is doing? Your heart is thinking everything. In fact, when you are sleeping, your heart is thinking. Amen? Your heart is doing what? He's thinking. People that used to study about dreams, they said if you have seen something during the day and you are thinking about that thing during the day, there's a possibility that when you sleep, you meet yourself acting that thing like in your dream. Amen? And parents used to tell children, especially this time they call Halloween. I'm not condemning, that's why we should discourage our children participating in all this Halloween, all these evil images. Somebody dead object with blood flowing, they put in front of their house, and you walk in every day, you see that. It says something, shouldn't surprise that kind of family when one of the children will wake up in the night and say, hey, mommy, I saw skeleton running after me.
Why would skeleton run after that person when in the front of the house there is a skeleton with blood all over and the person is dead with all the teeth out and this? How do you expect such a person? Because that person has filled his heart with such images. There's tendency when you sleep, because your heart is still working when you are sleeping, your mind is still thinking when you are sleeping, then you can see yourself jumping this. You see one old, rugged, a 150-year-old woman with all the skeletons running after and jumping this, and you say, it's what? Halloween. I'm not condemning, you all know the history. I'm just a man called catapulted into America. I don't know much because I'm still studying it. Amen? But I know everything is business. Everything is what? We saw how many billions of dollars people gain in all this Halloween with candy and all those things, and they're going around, going around in the night, asking for candy, all over, knocking the doors. The Lord will help us in Jesus' name. I'm not condemning, but I highly discourage that heart. Amen? And I was telling my daughter, she asked me, she said, oh, I want to go and attend a Halloween party. I said, that's my little one. With wisdom, they said, no, don't attend it. I don't like it. Said, why, daddy? That's what why I will have to find a way to kind of explain to her with, I don't want to push her away, you know? So we have to be very wise. There are trust informations that Christians can take to explain why we shouldn't allow our kids to get involved in things that can be very, that can have some spiritual or spiritist implications in the future. I don't bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
The heart of man, let's put it under control. Let's guide it as much as possible. Let us know one thing, that your heart can think evil and think good. It depends on you and your scope in life and your environment, your exposure. If you expose your mind into things of God, if you expose your heart to the Word of God, it will heal all that the heart may want to do that is negative. That's what we are just trying to encourage ourselves. That you are in charge, you are in control. Think right, think good. Be careful people that you associate with. Be careful what is coming into your mind. Be careful the soul that you are going to take. You are never going to regret it in Jesus' name. There are people, after they have heard God's word, they will not listen. The time of remembering God's word will be when they are in prison, when they have been indicted for committing murder. This thing starts just in a second. Remember that kiss is why it starts just in a single thought in a second. A woman that kills his wife and his husband, her husband, start just with a single thought that will just drop in. Just drop in, crime. People that have committed crimes, ask them. It's just a little thought that will just come into them. And where the thought will start from, we start from the advantages of the heart. Not the repercussions of the heart, but the advantages. And as they are dwelling on the advantages, never think of the consequences. The Lord will bless you in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Ask people questions. I mean, read news. You will see that some hearts that people started from their heart, the consequences, the level of the consequences, they can never imagine. The man in Alu, in Nigeria, the chief of the town or the city, who's supposed to be a wise man, who's supposed to be in charge of his town, according to the news, they came to you, they told you that this somebody stole, or these people stole, four students, that they are thieves. According to the news, they said the man ordered that they should go deal with them, that they used to deal with people. And to the level that these people were killed, roasted. Now, they never thought in their mind that act of trying to make judgment on thieves will cause them to be exposed, to be paraded like criminals, a whole sheep of the town being in prison. If that sheep will have thought in his mind that he can go to jail because of doing that, you think he's going to do it?
No.
So this little thought will go into his mind. So he will forget that there is God. Even if the government of this world will not take justice, God is a God of justice. You take life that you cannot create, you give answer to God. So let us think about this. We can be the best that God wants us to be. Amen?
Amen.
If you can listen to God's word, you can be the best and the perfect person that God wants you to be. Everything is embedded in God's word. But the choice is yours. To do good or to do bad, you have the choice.
But to every action, there is reaction. And that's why we are encouraging ourselves that we should do the right thing so that the reaction will be good reactions in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Think about your heart. Think about what you think. And as you are thinking about this, as you are allowing God to help you, and then at the end of it all, we shall have a place of peace with God in heaven in Jesus' name.
Amen.
Father, we thank you this afternoon. We bless you and worship for your mind, for your love for us. We thank you, Lord, for exposing our heart. You are the only one who know our heart. You are the only one who can say something about our heart. We don't know it. Jeremiah 17:9-10 explained to us that the heart is deceitful above all things and beyond cure. Who can understand it is a question mark. It, and he said, I, the Lord, search the heart. Because you know it. You created the heart. You created us. Our real self. Our soul. You created all these things. And you said, you examine the mind to reward each person according to their conduct, because you are the rewarder of those who diligently seek you. Help us, O God, to make our heart right with you in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
You said you reward us according to what our deeds are. We pray, Lord, that our deeds, as we continue to do them in this world, make them right according to your word. Help us, O Father, in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Is there anybody in this place today that is thinking of something evil? Or is just planning on doing something evil? Or is trying to recompense evil for evil? Daddy, we are asking today that you will convince that person of doing the right thing in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Two wrong cannot make a right. And of course, Lord, vengeance is yours. Help us, O God, to submit ourselves to you and do all according to your word and be patient, so that you can do it according to how you have planned it in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Is there anyone listening, oh God, to this message, and such a person is planning to do something, to commit a crime, to do something, even maybe to take a life? And we're asking, oh God, that this word that has come out will change such a person's act or action in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Father, it is good to serve you. Help us, oh God, to wait upon you, so that we can continue to renew our strength, so that we continue to help us, oh God, that our heart will be at the right heart with you, so that all the thought that we go in will be filters based on your word in the name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, precious Holy Spirit. Blessed be your name, oh God, forever.
Amen.
Help us, Lord, to continue to follow you in the days of our lives.
Amen.
You have said in your word in Psalm 3:1-3, said, blessed is the man that stands not in the counsel of the ungodly, nor sit in the seat of discomfort, nor stand in the way of sinners, but his delight is in your word. In your word he meditates day and night. You said he shall be like a tree planted by the rivers of water that brings forth its fruit in its season, that his leaves shall not do that, whatever he does shall prosper. Help us, O God, to do that so that we can prosper in all that we do in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Help us to meditate in your word in the mighty name of Jesus.
Amen.
Thank you, precious Holy Spirit, once again.
Father,
go with us as we go this week. And bring us back strong in the new month coming in November.
Amen.
That at the end of it all, we shall live with you in glory.
Amen.
In Jesus' name we have prayed.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.